choices and explore wild animals.
What, the volume? Hey, Mari?
Choice to influence the storyline, or choice in narrative character development. I love that marketing we're pushing this. It's an area that we really haven't explored enough in the last 20 years. Now, not every game needs to have this type of choice, but it's almost good when we as an industry try to expand the range of what we can do. But here's the thing. A lot of these games that say they're about choice aren't really about choice at all. What they are about is consequences. Games about choice are about making you reflect on what you're about to do as you do it, about thinking it through as you go in. Games about consequences, instead, are about making you realize the impact of something you did. Now, Heavy Rain, All of Its Faults, has a scene where you're confronted with the choice to either cut off your finger to get more information about how to save your son, or to refuse to do so. This is something players have to sit down and evaluate when they go to make a choice. It's not a calculation because there are no numbers here, no definitive right or wrong, but there are a lot of factors to consider and choose between. Do you cut off your finger because you owe it to your son? Do you not do so because you might bleed out or get infected and die? Do you take the thought of your own hand because you can't rightly say that one of your fingers is worth more than someone's life? Or do you refuse because screw you, nobody's going to tell you? These are all things the player weighs before they press the button, and because that's the case, it's scary. On the other hand, consider the first 30 minutes of the project.
It wasn't that loud. That was the, I don't think it's not my computer. It wasn't my computer, trust me.
Hold on.
There are things that you ponder or stop and weigh your options over. In fact, for many of them, you have nothing to do with it. Weigh them against. They're just little mini games or side choices that you can engage in. It's only after their consequences are revealed that you're given a reason to think about them. The results give context to your actions and make an effect on them. Were you a jerk for stealing that man's lunch? How come you didn't even think about it at the time? Did you do it just because it looked like an item you could pick up? What does that say about you and or product? So to recap, games about choice and games about consequence may all differ by when they get the player to think about the action that causes the ultimate result. Choice makes you think before you take the action. Consequence makes you think about it later when you see the action's result. Now these can both be interesting, but they have different effects and they require different approaches to design. If the focus is on the choice itself, the engagement is found in giving the player a number of different factors to weigh their choice on without reducing it to a calculation. What's most interesting here is what we find out about ourselves by finding out what we actually value in the child. You may say that you'd make any sacrifice to save a child, but when it comes down to it, what would you really do? Choices engage us by forcing us to see nuances that we may not have previously considered. The choice we talked about in one of our earliest episodes about erasing the gap in Mass Effect 2 highlights this. It strips away the black and white and doesn't give us any emotional resistance from the decision. The choice is no longer some abstract hypothetical where it's easy to talk in absolutes. Now it's specific. Messy and real and immediate. It's brilliant. If, on the other hand, the focus is on consequences, on revealing to the player the effects of their actions, then as a designer, you really have to think through what statements you're making for that reason. Simply thwarting the player or showing that things they did had bad results doesn't necessarily mean anything. Instead, you have to really figure out a chain of causality that runs from the player taking the initial action to the results you plan to show them, and what that chain says about the world. You also have to think about how the player feels about this result. You often want an emotional reaction, but you want to completely recover from the experience. If you aren't careful, the player may feel that you're seeing the game's cheating by allowing an outcome they didn't like or intend, and how they may feel like they didn't really have any control over. If you can pull it off, though, you can really get the player to ponder actions that they otherwise have simply taken without thinking, and cause them to question some of the assumptions they may walk through this world with. The Witcher series sometimes does this to great effect, and it's pretty much the entire premise of Spec Ops The Line, which I'm never going to stop saying because you can really play. And, of course, the distinction between choice and consequence can get quite blurry, and I'm not by any means saying that a player can't have some moments that are about choice and other moments that are about understanding consequence. But it's an important distinction for both players and designers to understand, and it's a distinction that I think we as an industry have glossed over far too long. See you next week.
How are the thing about the games that unfold and the I don't remember the name of it. I thought that was interesting.
I hate that noise.
In the early 1930s, a man named Burgess Frederick Skinner began to study psychology in a radical new way. See, before him, we only knew how to condition reactions. We could condition a person to be terrified of pumpkins or hungry on the side of office supplies. But Skinner theorized that you could go one further. He theorized that you could condition volition, that you could change the way that people made choices. So why are we talking about it? Because a vast number of today's games are built upon Skinner's discoveries, and it's starting to become a bad habit. But before I get ahead of myself, let's take a closer look at what Skinner did. Skinner created a machine, a simple box with a button in it, that he would put pigeons in. When the pigeons pecked at the button, the machine would give them food. He then hooked the box up to a recording device, so he could tell how often the pigeons pecked the button. Seems simple enough, so why was this so groundbreaking? Because pecking the button is active. This wasn't just an automatic reaction to stimulus, it involved making a decision. So if Skinner could show that he could consistently change how often the pigeons pecked the button, he could show that he could condition them to make a specific choice. This is called operant conditioning. Now, there were two amazing parts to his findings. One, operant conditioning works on humans. Two, simply rewarding someone every time they do an action isn't the best way to keep them continually doing that action. Rather, if you provide a reward to a person after they perform the action a random number of times, or only give a reward once every so many minutes, these methods are far more effective at conditioning someone to repeat an action. Skinner often talked about operant conditioning in terms of gambling. Most gambling games are not rigged for gamblers, though. And oddly enough, most gamblers are well aware of this. And yet, they continue to gamble rather than perform an equally strenuous job that has a regular payout with a higher net profit. Consider which activity people will tell you is more fun. Spending 8 hours in a casino playing the slots and ending up with $100. Or pushing a button in a factory for 8 hours and getting a paycheck for $100 at the end. This is all compounded by another discovery in Skinner's research. He demonstrated that primary conditioners, or rewards that are fundamental biological needs, have a diminishing effect once a person reaches satiation, or the biological limit of their needs. But then there are secondary reinforcers, things outside the biological realm, like money or social affirmation. These things generally don't hit us. You can probably see where we're going with this. Many of you have played Farmville or World of Warcraft well past the point where it was fun. Why? Because those games are very clearly built around rewards schedules. The entire design of both of those games is to condition you to continue to repeat an action that has